Nice to have you with us.
Death.
in 2017. Something else close to Anne Margaret's heart. She made multiple trips to Southeast Asia during the Vietnam War to help keep up morale in her own unique way, on both land and sea.
What was it like going to Vietnam and performing for the troops?
I was there in 1966 and 1968. Boy, you talk about my heart pumping. Woo! Ow! When the flash
begins. But back home, she was tired of being typecast as the singing sex kitten and wanted to prove she could hold her own in a dramatic role. She got her chance in 1971 when director Mike Nichols cast her opposite Jack Nicholson as his tragic lover in Carnal Knowledge.
The reason I sleep all day is because I can't stand my mind.
What mind?
Sleeping all day!
How did Carnal Knowledge change how people saw you?
Oh my gosh. They thought I could act.
And the Academy voters thought so too. She earned her first Oscar nod for a film that her own parents couldn't bear to watch.
Daddy never saw it. He knew what it was about, and he didn't want to see it because of obvious things. And I understood.
Of course, of course. But how was that for you to have people say, oh, she's a serious actress?
I was thrilled. I never planned for anything like that.
In a 60-year career, there are some things that haven't changed, like her love for motorcycles. What is it about motorcycles?
Speed. You know, being outside with the wind and rain and whatever out there. It's just exciting.
This is cool.
Yes.
This girl, Harley, is her latest.
Can I get on it?
Yeah. Excuse me.
Yes. Pardon me.
She says that she still rides on occasion.
Splash, I was taking a bath.
And that she's seeing someone. And how's that to find love?
It's a nice feeling. He's not a stranger.
No. And then Miss Margaret.
Aunt Margaret still makes the rounds at various Hollywood functions. And she has a new film set for release later this year. The woman who came to fame singing bye-bye isn't ready to say farewell just yet.
Does it seem a little surreal even as you tell this story
now? Oh, yes. My whole life. How can this happen? I'm so thankful for everything. And, I'm very thankful that I have another day. Yep.
Like live.
Surprised and inspired. Here's Jim Axelrod.
When this year's Grammy nominee was...
Hello to you, I'm Gail King.
John Batiste heard his name 11 times.
John Batiste.
John Batiste.
John Batiste. The most of any artist this year. 8 for his album, We Are. And 3 for his work on the soundtrack of the movie Soul.
They just kept calling your name.
I was really floored every single time.
We Are demonstrates his extraordinary range.
When I hold my body just like this, I come alive, I feel like freedom.
From his funky New Orleans roots, heard on the track Freedom, that dares you not to dance. To the classical jazzy hybrid, Move to the Left.
You said God gave us 12 notes.
Yeah.
What did you do with those 12 notes on these two albums that is responsible for such a claim?
I've always thought that you have a sound, and a sound represents something. Like you hear a sound. Are you hearing a sound? Are you hearing a sound? Are you hearing a sound? say that the music is always speaking to you. If you're listening, it's telling you what to do. It's not what did I do with it, it's what did it tell me to do.
The most honored artist this year with 11 nominations is Mr. John Batiste, right there.
Best known for his day job, the band leader on The Late Show with Stephen Colbert. John Batiste is no one's wingman. But if you're thinking things couldn't be any better for John Batiste, don't.
One thing that I've learned from this time is it can all go away. Things can change very quickly. From one day to the next, your world can be turned upside down.
8 days before the nominations, on the eve of his 35th birthday, the love of his life, author Saleka Jawad, got sucker punched.
How are you?
Yeah, a lot has changed in a year.
We first met Saleka last year as she was launching her bestseller, Between Two Kingdoms, a wise and moving meditation on healing from the leukemia that interrupted her life in her 20s.
Are you healed?
To say that I'm healed would be to imply that there's an end point.
How prophetic that turned out to be.
Not only was my leukemia back, but it was far more aggressive than it had been a decade ago.
The biggest day of John's professional life last fall was Saleka's first day of chemo in her second battle with cancer.
We're sitting in this chemo suite together, and these phone calls of congratulations are coming in, and we're having to hold these two realities.
Their world was shaking, but John and Saleka were determined to find their balance.
It's holding the absolutely, you know, gutting, heartbreaking, painful things and the beautiful, soulful things in the same palm of one hand. And it's hard to do that, but you have to do that, because otherwise the grief takes over.
Which brings us to this past February and their idea of how to best meet their harrowing reality.
You are married.
We are married. We've been secret married until this moment. We had this tiny, beautiful little ceremony. We didn't have wedding bands. We used bread ties.
Together for 8 years, the night before her bone marrow transplant struck them as the perfect time to make it official.
Okay, this has happened, but this isn't going to interrupt the plan that we have. This is just a bump in the road.
And something like getting married can be an act of optimism, an act of declaration, an act of we have a future.
Yes. It's an act of defiance.
Absolutely.
The darkness will try to overtake you, but just turn on the light. Focus on the light. Hold on to the light.
But married or not, Omicron meant John couldn't stay with Saleka after the transplant. She was alone, with only her fear to keep her company.
The quiet moments of kind of hollow suffering in the hospital, where you suddenly sit with yourself and you sit with what's happening to you.
Utter isolation.
And I expressed something to that effect to John, and next thing I know, I see him hunched over his computer, and half an hour later, he starts playing his lullaby. And every single day after that, he wrote me a new lullaby, and it felt like he was right there, you know, sleeping by my bedside.
They have healing properties to the music.
Did you wrote this just for her,
right,
to provide support and strength?
Yes, absolutely. And to fill the room with its healing properties. For me, that's my way. Everybody will have their way, you know? But seek that. Meditate on that. Focus on those things. Find those things.
They are now both finding those things, confronting the worst by relying on their best.
Finding some form of creative expression to express what feels impossible to express the unendurable, has been so important.
Selective focus is on the serious. Painting self-portraits depicting her treatment. And the whimsical.
We have yet to name her.
Bedazzling the walker, she now uses at the age of 33.
So now, instead of looking at this walker and feeling a sense of dread, it kind of makes me happy.
As for John, next month at Carnegie Hall, he debuts American Symphony. His work reflecting the tension between America's ideals and its realities. Our bright day and our dark night.
The night theme evokes a chant like quality.
Home more often means food odors. I'm the master reptile.